Good morning, everybody, and welcome to a Thursday edition of It's Gorgamatic. We've got the full house because it's Thursday. There he is, Kevin Gorg, a.k.a. Gorgamatic, and joining us once again is our Minnesota State Senator from District 54, Senator Karla Bigham. Good morning, you guys, and welcome.
Good morning. Hey,
good morning.
It's Thursday, which means it's another good week of awesome football.
Yes. That's right. Here we go again, right?
Let's dig in. I love it. Yeah, she's right. You know, this it does whet your appetite. Tonight's game absolutely could be called a clunker. And yes, I'm a Broncos lover, but these two teams right now are dealing with mass units as far as injuries go. It's still going to be Thursday night. It's still football. We're still going to watch. We're still going to play.
This whole LPSN thing I'm doing here is so much therapy for me because it allows me to like verbalize things that I couldn't say, you know, before I like didn't have a platform to say it. But, you know, when the Minnesota Miracle or Minneapolis Miracle, whatever you want to call it, happened, and everybody was like super happy, I was like, ugh. My wife's like, why are you not going crazy? I go, this means Teddy's gone. Teddy's going to leave. They're going to re-sign Case Keenum. He'll be their quarterback, and Teddy is gone. And here they are tonight, and all I wanted for the Vikings to do at that point was to bring in Teddy Bridgewater on his healing leg and Case Keenum and go, Case, you played great last year, but we don't really know. You know, is this a – I mean, everything worked for Case Keenum in 2017. Everything he threw up worked. And they go, Teddy, you were great. You were just coming into your own before this leg injury, but we don't know. So we're going to bring you guys both back next year. This is your contract. This is your contract. You guys get to compete. And whoever wins the job will be the Vikings starting quarterback. And, of course, they went and they signed Kirk Cousins. So,
yep.
I'm still a Teddy fan. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. You got to love the guy. Yeah, you know, as far as, you know, on the field goes, he's probably middle of the road. But off the field, he's Hall of Fame. He's just a great kid. Always had the right attitude. I remember that birthday video that went viral with the
hey,
young
Teddy.
Man. That Yeah, the hey, Teddy thing. And, of course, Teddy shows up, right? I mean, that's the kind of – character you're dealing with. So he's a guy we all can pull for.
Yeah. He's just, you know, he just was, is one of those guys that the team rallies around, and you need that leader, just that genuine, authentic leader that is going to rally, the guys, in those tough times. He was kind of able to do that, but, I agree with Kevin. I mean, on a actual quarterback side of it, he hits the middle of the road, and Case has got an arm, and I know we'll get into this, and I know we also want to talk a little bit about the wild Tim, but
and the rules,
but Case has got a good arm, you know, and I think it's going to have an impact on the game today, more than if Baker Mayfield played even with the injury on his non-throwing arm, serious injury on his non-throwing arm.
Yeah, and you know, you guys, I'm reluctant. I keep wanting to say, no, Teddy's better than that, but the numbers really don't bear it out.
Right.
And maybe it's always been the leg, or maybe it's always been because he was undefeated when he was with New Orleans, you know, that supporting cast around him.
Yeah, and it could be the supporting cast that's been around him too and on the teams. But, man, when he was here, he had some good players. I mean, he had Diggs. I mean, he had some really quality Rudolph quality players that.
And some really bad ones his first year. I still vividly remember you watch him at the line of scrimmage. Every time he checked it, he turned around, had to walk back to 28 and go, this is what you need to do on this play. Because 28 had 9 years in the league, had no idea what he was supposed to do other than, am I getting the ball or am I not getting the ball?
No, I get that, Timmy. And he did put the Vikings in a position to win a playoff game. And then we've got the Blair Walsh. Wide left, which again, Vikings fans.
Why would you
I mean,
bring
we just
that up? Why would
because
you bring
we
that
live
up?
With it. You know,
it's like bringing
Anderson,
up 1998, Kevin. Don't bring up 1998.
But it's true.
That's the carnage that we live with here as local football fans. I mean, it's sad but true. I mean, if you want to look for one word that defines the Vikings organization, and I'm 54. They've been around my entire life. It's heartbreakers. I mean, that's who they've been, and we love them. There's passion in this town. We've got legendary players going back to, you know, the Purple People Eaters and Fran Tarkenton, but this franchise comes back to being heartbreakers.
And the last preseason, excuse me, Carla, but the last preseason game Teddy played, I think it was against the Colts, and he only played like part of the first half. It looked like child's play. And I was so excited for the season ahead. I go, everybody's going to see Teddy, you know, for what he was in college. And then the knee thing happened and everything changes.
Yeah, speaking of quarterbacks, I was very intrigued by social media this week with Kirk Cousins. I saw a guy that was making some bad decisions, throwing the ball behind him, and just some really questionable progressional, you know, decisions. And he gets it done. He shouldn't be in these positions to have to claw himself out. I think it's very cautious. I just think he's not playing with urgency. And then he's the one that has to kind of save the day. And he's not clutch like Aaron Rodgers, Tom Brady are clutch, right? Like, I just think it's an interesting dynamic that played out on social media this week with him. And, I mean, yeah, this guy's the numbers are good. I mean, you can't deny that. And he's got a phenomenal surrounding cast with him. But I just, it doesn't feel right. It just doesn't sit right with me that we've got to come to these close games. I personally think we should only have one loss. We should only have one loss on our record right now. And so, I don't know. It's just, it's kind of been a discussion this week at the Bigham Steckman household. And it's just interesting playing out on social media. And I'm glad they have a bye week. Maybe they'll get some stuff sorted out for the final stint of the season, but I don't know.
KG?
Well, if I handicap the first six games of the Vikings, Kirk Cousins is so far down the list on what ails this football team. It's like a grocery list. I'm getting down to the nitty gritty. I mean, the defense and special teams is what the problem is. And say what you want. You know, the kicking game continues to be an issue. And then you get a lead against Carolina. They've got 96 yards to go. You've stuffed them all day long, and in typical Viking fashion, they drive the length of the field, they score a touchdown, and then they get the two-point conversion. It's like, you know, Mike Zimmer is known as this great defensive coordinator. That's how he got his name, and it's how he earned this opportunity to be a head coach of our Vikings. Yet, when push comes to shove in big games, and I go back to the game after the Minneapolis Miracle, and their offense gives them the 7-0 lead at Philadelphia, and the defense then goes out and allows the next six drives to yield touchdowns for the Philadelphia Eagles with a backup quarterback named Nick Foles. You made him into a folk hero or a full hero, and it all comes back to the defense. So, no, I mean, Cousins is – he's never going to be Tom Brady. He's never going to be Aaron Rodgers, but you can win with quarterbacks. I mean, they won with Nick Foles, for God's sake.
Don't tell me Cousins
this is better than Nick Foles, and we do have the weapons. Carla's right. We have outstanding offensive weapons, but until you get the defense and the special teams figured out, you're going to end up 9-8 or 8-9. That's who this team is.
Right, and so, I mean, I don't disagree with anything you said, but I think for the amount of money we're paying him, the lack of urgency is just a concern, and let's be honest, that's who everybody focuses on, is the quarterback. But I think he's better than what he's playing. I mean, is maybe what I'm trying to say. Like, I know... I mean, look at that. You like that? You like that? I mean, he does it all the time. And yeah, if you could play like that for all four quarters, dude, and make the decisions and then let the other team, the other issues, the other woes of this team, which are defense and special teams. I don't know what we're going to do about a kicker. We just cannot get that play right. I don't know. But yeah, like, so we just got to figure that side out, but well, I don't know. It was just a discussion, and I just thought it was interesting how it blew up on social media.
Well, you know, you raise a good point. And another show we do at 9:30 in the morning called Let's Play Every Day, I brought this up and I said, you know, there's been this rethinking about Kirk Cousins, and I'm one of them. I was one of those that says, man, another year with this guy, get the season over with and get him out of here. Now I'm watching him every day and I'm going, or every week, and I'm going, are we really going to be better next year if he's not? Do you not bring him back? Because I would say that, you know, if you had to, like, right now at their break, the third of the way through, say, who has been their MVP? You could say they only should have one loss, but I would say they don't even have three wins without him. He's put them in position to win. Yeah. He can't kick it, you know?
Yeah.
So, but here's where one of our panelists, Heather Rule, brought up, I'm still waiting for the whole virus thing to come back. He is still, as far as we know, not vaccinated.
Yep.
So he may be this great guy who leads this whole drive, and all of a sudden we find out Kirk's got to enter concussion protocol, and he's not going to be there for the game against the Packers or the Bears or whatever it is. And what's going to happen then? You know, I mean, any goodwill he's engendered to that point,
gonna be out the door. Yeah, and he's the quarterback. To Carla's point, the team will feed off the quarterback like a hockey team feeds off a goaltender. A football team relies on that quarterback to be that smooth, steady air of confidence. And if he can't be out there because of COVID, how do you look your teammates in the eye and say, I gave it all up for you? And there is a contradiction there that cannot be denied. And, you know, I don't want to open up that can of worms, but I will tell you that if I'm one of his teammates that's been vaccinated and this team gets into a position where they can make the playoffs and all of a sudden he misses a week or two and they lose, I mean, that's going to be a real, I think, tough hurdle to overcome when looking at the long-term future of Kirk Cousins in Minnesota.
100%.
Well, excuse me, Carla. And in fairness, then, we also do have to put out the names Adam Thielen and Harrison Smith.
Dalvin Cook. Yeah. You're talking about a core of their superstar players. So it goes deeper than Kirk Cousins. I just think it gets magnified there because he is the quarterback.
And would not speak out about it, was asked about it directly, and you're right. So I'm glad you brought it up because I wasn't even aware that Dalvin Cook, it was four. I knew it was those three at least. Okay. On to some good stuff, okay? Taking a squeegee and just getting the negativity out of here because right now this town is on a roll. Yeah. We are winning. I just can't believe it. The Vikes are on the bye, but the Wild are 3-0. Kevin Gorg's been chronicling that. So, Carla, I wanted to ask you, so you're obviously a sports person. You like sports, it seems like. So where do you fall on the spectrum of Wild, Wolves, other sports?
I would say that Vikings, Wild, Twins, Lynx, Wolves. I'm just a big Minnesota sports fan, but I tell you what, so penny wise, pound foolish, the husband and I cut the cord for cable. So we're on Hulu.
Oh no.
Yeah. Look at, I think Kevin's crying already. So we couldn't see the game. So I was feverishly hitting refresh on my Twitter. And then I was watching the news and it was hilarious. Because it was all happening live during the sportscast. All the goals were happening. So they were all broadcasting live from the XL Center, and it was going nuts. And they're literally like, and the Wild scored another goal. And then they go into something else. And the Wild just scored another goal. It is now tied up. And the Wild just won. I mean, so it was fun to see that. But I want to hear, what did it feel like, Kevin, to be in there?
It was remarkable. I will say this, you know, since the Wild came into existence 21 years ago, this is only the second time I can honestly say I've been at a regular season game and it was an out of body experience that felt like a playoff game. The only other time I can say that was year number one. I was lucky enough to be in the building when the Dallas Stars came back for the very first time. And all of us as North Star fans had had our hearts literally ripped out of our chest. That was Norm Green's team. That was the team that they took away from us. And they came back here, and in our expansion year, Darby Hendrickson and the Wild put a 6-0 licking on them like you've never seen. And I'm telling you, that building was electric. Not until two nights ago had I felt anything like that for a regular season game. A big part of it was we haven't had a full crowd there in 19 months. And they came in there by one-ups. You could tell it was something different. Wes Walls made the point in our pregame show, 5 and 6 deep around the end boards to watch one-ups is something you don't see normally in October. And then once the game got going and we had the Foligno fight where he went crouching tiger, hidden dragon, and flew up on the guy. And the Superman. Building, it's the Jets, right?
Superman, I mean,
it was
puns. Intense.
It was so fun. And then the way it played out, it really was one of those nights that stands out in 21 years of watching Wild hockey games as something special.
Well, and they're just on fire right now. I mean, they're playing with such intensity. They're shooting. They're playing just in sync. They're intense. And you want to see that. I mean, it's, even though it's early, you want to see that. It's new. It's a new dynamic. And so I'm excited to watch it on Twitter.
You got to figure that out.
You
can't go through
around the corner.
You can't do this. You've got to figure that out. My parents, by the way, God bless them, Ken and Mary in Burnsville, same house I grew up in the early 80s, came to me a year and a half ago and said, hey, we're switching to Dish. We got this really cool deal. We're going to link up. You know, our landline's going to go away. We're going to have these cell phones. And they're in their 80s. I'm like, oh, no. And they're like, we get to watch the Wild. I said, no, we're not on Dish, guys. And they're like, no, the guy told me we have Fox Sports. I'm like, Dad, I'm telling you. They don't have – and so sure enough, last year starts, and he's all excited to watch Kaprizov, and I'm like, dude, you're not going to be able to watch Kaprizov. And he called me the day after the first game. He's like, you were right. I screwed this up.
Check your connection, Kim.
Yep, I'll do
check your connection. Okay.
How about now?
Perfect. Thank you.
I think it might have been the whole it's a conspiracy.
You guys are excited.
Somebody from Dish is trying to take me off the air.
So, yeah, right. So we're 15 minutes into this. We haven't gotten any of our football yet. And I just want to say one more thing before we do move on. So, you know, we had just something really, and during the pandemic, we had some really nice things happen here in Minnesota in the form of the Vikings drafted Justin Jefferson. Mm-hmm. The Minnesota Wild finally had Kirill Kaprizov arrive. And the Minnesota Timberwolves drafted a young man by the name of Anthony Edwards. Mm-hmm. And these three arrived all in the same year. And so we've all had a chance now, it's year two, to watch them play their sport, but also to observe them and to get a little bit of their personality and who they are as people. And I couldn't be more excited. I mean, years ago, we used to say, what if we could have hockey in St. Paul and basketball in Minneapolis? It would fit sort of the ethos of each of those cities. And we have that now. We got Kaprizov in St. Paul, and we got Ant and JJ in Minneapolis. And I just, this Anthony Edwards, that's another reason to get your cable back. I mean, I have not watched, I used to love basketball. I haven't watched NBA basketball forever. I watch him, and then I wait to hear what he's going to say after the game. He's like a bright light. If you can get Marnie Gellner's on-court interview with him, he's after the game, and he's like, I love this town. I love the fans. I love this arena. I love this team. I'm just lucky to be here. And you look at him, and you go, he means it. You know, he really is having fun doing this, and the kid can flat out play. We've got something going here. Mm-hmm.
We've got star power, and every sports fan at all levels wants to find young superstars they can identify with for years to come. You look at the Kaprizov jerseys around the XL Energy Center a couple nights ago. They're everywhere. Same thing at Target Center last night. Ant's got his following already. And, you know, I'll say this, and I'm like Karla, the Wolves are down that pecking order for me. I'm not going to lie and sit here and be some phony. But I will tell you, I was at the club this morning watching the replay of the game, which was on the TV right in front of me on my elliptical. And I was like, holy cow, their offense in the second half. And it's something we heard about last year when they had the coaching change to Chris Finch and how much they were going to play up tempo and transition basketball. What's changed for me, Timmy, and I'm not a basketball guy, but I can see and identify good defense, is they are blocking shots. They are hustling back to the board, and they are using that knowing that once they get the rebound or that turnover, they can run the floor and play transition basketball. So I'm watching D'Angelo Russell stop and pop for three. I'm watching Ant run the court. I'm watching Karl Anthony Towns take the ball, take two steps, and just slam it. That's a fun team to watch, bottom line. Are they a playoff team? I don't know, but I think they're going to be a super entertaining product.
Right, and I think the one thing I noticed yesterday, I was at an event down at the golf course, and they had it on, and they were rebounding very strong. They were in their fight and mixing it up to get the rebound. And again, another team that was playing with passion, and maybe because it's the beginning part of the season, and we'll see if this continues. But I did notice that was very intense.
Yeah. Well, I'm thinking if this kind of trend continues, that when they were introduced last night, Ant was introduced fourth and then Cat was introduced fifth. I'm thinking next year, you know, you may see that reverse, and nothing against Cat. You know, I think he's come in with great passion and he's conditioned to play, and I hope he plays great. But I just think this Edwards is, he's the real deal. So we have the senator here. We brought her in a couple of weeks ago, if you're seeing her for the first time, because we wanted to talk about the issue of sports gaming in Minnesota legalized. And she's one of the people that's leading that effort. And we were just so caught up with her enthusiasm and her intellect. And we said, we should have you back. And she actually did it, came back. And so now we look forward to Thursdays because we think big on Thursdays. That's, and that's right, where it starts, is with our state senator. And we've got the game tonight. We've got the Broncos taking on the Browns in Cleveland, both teams 3-3, both teams beat up. Let's think big. Where are we going?
Well, one, I think, and Kevin alluded to this, I think this is a buyer beware game because everything is banged up. Both teams are banged up pretty dang good. But I'm going to say that the Browns offensive line is pretty banged up, and their running game is non-existent as people know it. We have Chubb and Hunt that are both out, and that's one of the two leaders, and they're at least in the top 10, both of them, for yards in the NFL. And so you have a backup running back in Johnson with a new quarterback because Baker Mayfield's out, who sometimes you have to account for the run. He hasn't been running that much this year. But you have Case Keenum, who we've already established is a seasoned vet, who has an arm. And this Browns team has some weapons with Odell Beckham Jr. and People Jones, who had big play at the last game. And so I think that Case is going to throw it. I think Odell Beckham Jr. is going to have a big game. But I don't think we're running that much. So my big play is Johnson will not exceed 60 yards in the game tonight. So that's it. And then on the other side, we still don't know who's starting for the Broncos. It's going to be a game time decision where it's Bridgewater or Drew. Why am I drawing a blank to his last name?
Drew Locke.
Drew Locke. Locke's got a decent arm, but hasn't played much in the last two, like in this season for sure. And I think he played sporadically last year. And so he has some weapons on his side, but I really do feel that Bridgewater is going to utilize his receivers. And so I think, I only had one cup of coffee today. Why am I drawing a blank to the receiver?
You got it right here. Cortland Sutton.
It's Cortland Sutton.
Stud. He's a stud.
Wow. Too. Yeah. So Sutton is going to have,
you got to get yourself one of these, Karla.
Oh yeah. Instead of relying up here, you know, you hit 40 and it must just go.
Just wait till 50.
Yeah. You wait. Kevin and I are just like, yeah.
40. I'd give anything to be 40 again. Goodness.
So Sutton is going to have a big game. He's really done well for this team. He's really invigorated the offense and really had a connection. And so anyway, those are my two thinking Bigham this week.
I love it. What do you think, KG?
I think she's on the right track for sure. Beckham is a game time decision. Don't forget he got nicked up last week. And so I'd keep an eye on that. If you're a fantasy player that's looking to either play daily, or if you're in a season long and you've got Beckham, like the young lady I live with yesterday this morning, I said, is Beckham in your lineup? She said, yes. I said, well, I would keep an eye on that because he's 50-50 at best to play. Bridgewater, as of like an hour ago, was going to give it a go. He's had a little more mobility as the week's gone on. And Drew Locke, he's got all the talent in the world, but unfortunately, he's got the Vinny Testaverde disease. He's colorblind. He tends to throw it to the wrong guys. It's not good. It's not good at all. So, when fantasy football started back in September, I couldn't have picked out Dearness Johnson in a lineup with us three. I don't know who this guy is, but I know he's the next man in line. And I know my Denver Broncos last week made freaking Kenyon Drake look like Tony Dorsett. So I don't know that he's going to go over 60 yards, but Timmy, I'm going to bet you right now Dearness Johnson at some point is going to end up in the paint tonight. He's going to end up with a touchdown, probably a plunging variety. I mean, these two teams are so banged up. It's going to look like USFL out here. But Dearness Johnson gets a touchdown, and it's not a play on him as much as it's a play against my Broncos run defense. I saw gaping holes last week that the Raiders created on the road at Mile High at Vesco. And, you know, again, Kenyon Drake, give me a break. Now, to Carla's point on the stud receiver, I am a big, big fan, no pun intended, obviously, of Cortland Sutton. I mean, this guy is awesome. The last 2 weeks he's gone combined over 200 yards receiving, and Vegas has dropped the ball. The over-under on his receiving yards, let me get my cheaters on, 67.5? This is a gimme, Timmy. This is
So you're not playing total number of receptions, you're playing yards?
Over 67.5 yards. I don't understand this number. It's disrespectful. I mean, since Jerry Jeudy has gone out, this has been the focal point of their passing game. He and along with their tight end, Noel Fant, former Iowa Hawkeye, are the receiving core, period. Until Jeudy comes back, Sutton will be the featured receiver. I think 67.5 yards, even though Cleveland's defense is very good against the pass, I still think when Bridgewater, who likely will be playing catch-up football tonight, has to throw the ball, it's Cortland Sutton. So I'm going over 67.5 receiving yards.
You guys are on different parts of this now.
She's got the touchdown. I've got the yards. And when he goes for 896 and a tutty, we both win.
Okay.
That's right. That's right. The one thing I will say, just kind of about the Broncos with the run game, I saw, you know, and I agree with what Kevin said, but they did hold Josh Jacobs to 53 yards last week, which he's a stud. I mean,
he's banged up, but he's good.
Yeah, and then you never can count out Myles Garrett, but on the other side, you got Von Miller. Can't count him out either.
Love Von Miller.
No, yeah, love Von Miller, future Hall of Famer, hands down, first rounder. And so I think they have some real true good leadership on both defenses, seasoned, really good, just terrific athletes that know this game and that are going to come to play and have something to prove. And the last thing I'll say is with all these banged up things, people should also watch that people are going to take opportunities today that maybe have never had an opportunity to play, or they're a few years out where they're going to get that chance to start in a preseason, like kind of a normal path. This is an opportunity for Johnson, but for the two linebackers that were called up as well from the practice squad for the Browns, like you have to take that into consideration. They got something to prove.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, as I look at the game, Timmy, and the line is down to 2 now. It was as high as 3.5 at the start of the week. Yeah. And, you know, I'm torn. I'm a Broncos fan, and I'm a little frustrated with my team because they got up to that 3-0 start. They did so against a soft schedule. They have been competitive, though, in the last 3 losses. Bradley Chubb, one of their outstanding pass rushers, kind of the peanut butter and jelly part with Von Miller. Once he's gone out, their defense has really struggled to put any pressure on the quarterback. And I think Keenum's good enough, as we saw here in Minnesota, to manage this game. And so I'm going to lay the 2 points or 2.5 if it is with Cleveland tonight. And, you know, again, it's a head play, not a heart play. I'd love my Broncos to rise up, but they've been beaten by double digits now 3 consecutive weeks. And that game last week against the Raiders, yeah, they held Josh Jacobs to 56. Kenyon Drake scored twice. And if you watch that game, which I did on my flight home from California, they never got the Raiders into third and long. It was third and short, or it was 2 downs and moved the chains the entire second half. And that's just a red flag for me. So until I see otherwise from Denver, I've got to play the other side. I think the Browns are the right play tonight.
And I totally agree with Kevin. And I think that the caveat would be if Von Miller is charged up, has something to prove, and he creates turnovers and turns those turnovers into opportunity, meaning pick 6 and different things like that throughout the Denver's defense, that could change this. But I think it's going to be extremely close, but I would give it to Case for managing the game and home field in Cleveland.
Did you guys see any of the pregame comments that Von Miller made?
No.
Mm-mm. It sounds like, and I didn't read the article, but I saw somewhere, it sounds like he's got something personal against whoever he's going up against tonight.
Uh-oh.
Has made some statements like,
I wouldn't like that.
And I'm not going to say what he said, but it's like, no, I'm going to get this guy. And so I'm interested to see that. But let's face it, this should be a 2 Chubb ball game tonight. And we have no Chubbs.
No Chubbsy. I've got him in one of my fantasy season longers.
But each team's got a Chubb.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. 2 Chubb game. Chubb versus Chubb. You're right.
No Chubb. Yeah. Where's the Chubb?
No Chubby. It's sad.
Well, you guys, this is great. This half hour goes whoosh, just like that.
It's the best one of the week every week. And seriously, I love the conversation, and I love the passion here on this show. And so, yeah, it does. Timmy, it flies right by.
It does. It does. It's fantastic. And I appreciate the opportunity to be on to talk about Minnesota sports. This is awesome.
We love to have you as part of this. You class up the joint, and there's no doubt about that. We like having you as part of this. Thank you for giving us the big play, and good luck with your guys' picks tonight. And as you said, KG, let's have Cortland Sutton go off, and everybody goes home happy.
That's what we're looking for tonight. He will be a focal point of my daily fantasy, and I think it's going to be, even though it's 2 teams right now that are struggling and banged up, under the spotlight of Thursday Night Football, you know it's going to be good.
Kevin, I'm going to see you in a half hour.
Yes, sir.
All right, we've got Kevin coming on for Let's Play Every Day. That's coming up at 9:30, where we take on the sports talkers of the day. Then at 11 o'clock, it's back. That is Let's Play Super Draft. We're talking about your daily fantasy sports plays for tonight's game between the Broncos and the Browns. That'll do it for this episode. Thank you, Karla. Have a great week.
You too. You too.
Great to have you with us for the senator, for the congressman, Congressman Gorgamatic. I'm Tim McNiff saying, you know, none of what you saw today here is automatic, but you'll never, ever, ever see this show when it will not be 159% Gorgamatic.